this play.
There we go. Catch.
Players working together with life to create blood.
And for a long time, we didn't have a word for it, a phrase for it. And finally, I was just like, well, it's like gummy bears. It's like when you put the gummy bears, you can hold light, and so it ended up becoming the catchphrase. We just call it the gummy.
Father Nemo, their illumination is probably 80% this gummy substance in them, and then we just augment the surface lighting to get it to look like, you know, they've got some sort of surface on top of all this. If they're too gummy, then you can't see any detail, you can't read any expression. So it's like finding that right balance to get them to look like they're both glowy and readable at the same time.
To ships that end up at the bottom of the ocean is they rest and they decay. Smacking in of a huge great white shark into a door would release a bunch of sort of rust particles, silt, which would settle onto that stuff, would get knocked up, and the water would get a lot murkier locally in the area, and you see the silt kind of puff up and then settle back out. The key thing about doing silt and making it believable really has to do not so much with how it gets kicked up. Dust also responds on top of your refrigerator. You smack it up with fridge dust and kick up in the air. It has to do with how it settles out. And things slow down a lot faster in water. Water is way more viscous than air, as people know. And so when Bruce the Shark knocks silt off the door or off the ground or something, as it is ejected into the water around him, it sort of flies in quickly, but then immediately slows down, is eased out by the water, and then gently settles out into gravity. But once it's in the air, Bruce's tail then sort of swims by and kicks it, and also react to that as well. Keeping track of all those dynamic interactions underwater is quite difficult to do. We spend a lot of time and attention to make that look believable. And when it's done right in a shot, suddenly that adds a whole different additional level of believability to being underwater, which is a key story point in the film. An exposure underwater has different sort of properties than one in air do. You typically get the spider ball that goes big, goes small again, and leaves behind it a mushroom cloud of smoke that rises up to the water. Lighting also plays a huge component in connecting each one of the explosions to the ones that are local to it, so that when one of these things popped off, it would flash on all its neighbors, it would also then move them out, they'd pop off, they'd light the ones next to them, and carry on and so forth, all the way through the entire set until the whole thing's left, one big popcorn explosion of red and orange and yellow and horribleness.
What did you think when you found out that the character had been named after you?
I think it's great. It's a little bit of a mixed bag because she's kind of a, is it the word villain?
beginning, and it'll sort of ramp down over the progression of the shot. And so the first thing we do is start out with the thing that got dumped ball defenders, because it looks like, you know, big Chuck E. Cheese ball pit. Problem is, sometimes water doesn't do what you want, right? So we showed this directly, but, well, I don't think he could talk, you know, if he was under that much water. And then once we get something that we're happy with at this ball pit level, then we'll go and we'll actually try to form a mesh out of it. This sort of takes all the particles, and then where there's a lot of particles, or where it really should be a, you know, solid mass of water, it gives us the solid surface that we can use. And then everywhere else, you get these particles. And we're pretty happy with how this looks. It's out of his face now, so we can actually do his facial expressions. And then it'll go to shading and lighting. It'll do this like a fancy sort of transparency. And we'll, you know, actually make it look more. And then that sort of puts your lipstick.
net itself, though, is in Sarshot's hero, because he couldn't get that kind of close connection between net and fish without animating by hand. But in Farshot's, it's done simulated. But of course, the simulator isn't doing all like that. You're right, some fish have a tail sticking out, some fish get stuck outside the net, want to go back in, which is, of course, completely insane. So to kill those fish and clip the other fish off to make them fit inside the net shape, there was a whole team of folks who had to work on that stuff with animators to make sure that the amount of activity of the fish, how anxious they were in the scene, how organized or chaotic they were, is all controlled through the scene across those cuts.
So just then the sea cucumber looks over the mollusk and says, "That's not a barnacle, that's Grandpa." So just then the sea cucumber looks over the mollusk and says, "Not partially mackerel, holy mackerel." So just then the sea cucumber looks over the mollusk and says, "Hey, this tastes like carp."
At Pixar, it is a tremendous collaboration. Have such amazing artists working together to do these films. We couldn't do it any other way. Unfortunately, this past year, we lost one of our greatest collaborators. He's a great animator, a great friend, and a fantastic family man. His name was Glenn McQueen. He was the heart and soul of our animation department. We thought we'd cut together a little bit of Glenn for you to see, you know, see what a great guy he was. Glenn is not gone from us. He's still alive.
You know, I met lots of nice people there, too. I did. I got to go to a real Hawaiian hula party. You want to see it, huh?
Every film that gets released, I think of it as like, it's like you're planning a surprise party for the world, you know? Because no one else knows what you got here, you know, but you can, like, oh, you're going to, like... Underwater has some different sort of properties than ones in air.
one of the explosions to the ones that are local to it, so that when one of these things popped off, it would flash on all its neighbors, who would also then move them out. They'd pop off, they'd like the ones next to them, they'd carry on and so forth, all the way through the entire set until the whole thing's like one big popcorn explosion of red, orange, and yellow, and purple.
What did you think when you found out that a character had been named after you?
I think it's great. It's a little bit of a mixed bag, because she's kind of a, is it the word villain? I have played a million practical jokes on Mr. Andy Stanton, and I think it's just his way of getting back.
Klaus. Klaus, the pinata's drooping. No, E equals MC squared, and you know it as well as I do.
You have a bad haircut, Dumpy.
Who's there? A banana who? Aren't you glad? Big money! No whammies.
Small loose particles. And then there's a transition zone where if you watch a wave as it comes up, it'll come up and break into little tiny particles. These little blobs that still look clear, but they still look like water, and then they fragment more in terms of spread. It's the believability of that transition that's the hardest thing to do right in computer-generated water. And the reason is when we model something with particles, the particles we use are bigger than the size of the spray drop, just because of the computation. Wanted to do a shot like the whale tongue shot, you would really need billions of particles of water. But we can't do that. We can at most do millions. And so we have a lot of tricks that go into taking this fairly coarse screen description of dynamics, turning it into a surface as the surface moves around, and then cheating the transition in various ways of the surface from a solid surface of water breaking down into spray and then splashing.
We'll get a shot like this on an animation, right? And have it, no water, just the character sort of holding on. And the director would tell us, oh, I want like a whole ton of water at the beginning. It'll sort of ramp down when we get another shot. So the first thing we do is we start out with the thing that got dubbed ball pit renders, because it was like, you know, big Chuck E. Cheese ball pit. The problem is, sometimes the water doesn't do what you want, right? So we showed this to the director, and he's like, well, I don't think he can talk, you know, under that much water. And then once we get something that we're happy with at this ball pit level, then we'll go and we'll actually try to form a mesh out of it. This sort of takes all the particles, and then where there's a lot of particles, or where it really should be a, you know, a solid mass of water, it gives us the solid. And then everywhere else there's particles. And we're pretty happy with how this looks. It's out of his face now, so it can actually be
no. One of the problems is that water is really not one thing. When you look at a scene with water, there's the water surface itself, and then there's spray, which is really just small loose particles. And then there's a transition zone where if you watch a wave as it comes up, it'll come up and break into little tiny particles, little blobs that still look clear. They still look like water, and then they fragment more and turn into spray. It's the believability of that transition that's the hardest thing to do right in computer-generated water. And the reason is, when we model something with particles, the particles we use are bigger than the size of a spray drop, just because of the computational requirements. If you really wanted to do a shot like a whale-tongue shot, you would really need billions of particles of water, but we can't do that. You know, we can at most do millions. And so we have a lot of tricks that go into taking this fairly coarse grain description of the dynamics, turning it into a surface as the surface moves around, and then cheating the transition in various ways of the surface from a solid surface of water breaking down into spray and then splashing off. We get a shot like this out of animation, right, that has no water, you know, just the character sort of holding on. And the director will tell us, oh, I want like a whole ton of water at the beginning, and it'll sort of ramp down over the progression of the shot. And so the first thing we do is we start out with these things that got dumped ball pit renders because it looks like, you know, big Chuck E. Cheese ball pit. Problem is, sometimes water doesn't do what you want, right? And so we showed this to the director, and he's like, well, I don't think he could talk, you know, if he was under that much water. And then once we get something that we're happy with at this ball pit level, then we'll go and we'll actually try to form a mesh out of it. This sort of takes all the particles, and then where there's a lot of particles, or where it really should be a, you know, a solid mass of water, it gives us the solid surface that we can use. And then everywhere else, you get these particles. And we're pretty happy with how this looks. It's out of his face now, so it can actually read his facial expressions. And then it'll go to shading and lighting. It'll do this like fancy sort of transparency, and we'll, you know, actually make it look like water. And then that's sort of what you end up seeing.
Love for this world and all the creatures that have been evident, everything he said and did. And when he heard we were making a film about the penguins and Antarctica, he said, this is important. Ha 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 ha.